Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Bogart on Movies, right here on WXEL-TV in beautiful Palm Beach County. This week, along with some newer movies, we'll look at the Elia Kazan Brando classic On the Waterfront. We'll take a fun ride with Carla's Campy Pics. We'll answer your emails, and for my special pick, a documentary I think is the best ever. So let's get going. First off, another movie I was really looking forward to. It's Broken City, starring Mark Wahlberg and Russell Crowe. That is, I was looking forward to it. Then I saw it.
There's some wars you fight, and some wars you walk away from. This is the fighting kind.
Green Sally up, and Green Sally down.
When I was elected mayor, this was a broken city. Tell me things haven't changed.
You know who I am?
Yeah.
Step by step, I have been getting it fixed.
That's all right. Calm down, okay?
Tell me things haven't changed. Here's our guy.
Mr. Mayor.
You, in my eyes. Hero.
Thank you.
You ever do any hunting? You should try it. You would be a natural.
I'm not sure I'm following you, Mayor.
I need you to find the son of a bitch who's sleeping with my wife.
Done. All right, Katie, get my eyes. What do we have?
Well, I got him, and it's good, Billy.
You have an envelope of photographs that I paid for.
Now, the movie's about Detective Billy Taggart, played by Wahlberg, who left the force after a controversial shooting, who's been hired by Mayor Hostetler, not quarterback Jeff Hostetler, played by Russell Crowe, to investigate his wife's dalliances, played by the again just okay but gorgeous Catherine Zeta-Jones. The catch is Crowe has the goods on Wahlberg, courtesy of a videotape of the shooting.
What can I do for you, Billy?
I don't know why you hired me.
Stick with the adultery narrative. It's sexier.
Yeah, lies are always sexier. Unfortunately, I've had enough this week to last me a lifetime.
I hired you to investigate my wife.
Investigate her for what?
For not minding your own business is for what? For having a big mouth is for what? For asking too many questions is for what? You better be careful following her example, Billy. I might have to hire someone to investigate you.
Yeah. You're good, man. I'll give you that. You got it all worked out, huh?
Perhaps that's why the people keep electing me, Billy. Because I simply get the job done.
So all this, it was all for the city?
Everything I do is for this great city. I chose you because I own you.
The problem here is, well, everything. First of all, Russell Crowe. Dude, what's with the haircut? Would a New York City mayor ever be seen looking like that? And the accent, I have no idea where that came from. Then there's the actual acting part. It's really not very good at all. Now, I like Mark Wahlberg, and he's not bad in this, although I think he's much better as a comedy actor. But his character's a jerk, a murderer, and certainly no one to root for. Then there's Barry Pepper as the candidate running against Crowe. Well, he's just ridiculous. An emotional wreck and too over the top. Add that to bad direction and a script that's all over the place, confusing, and totally unbelievable, and you've got a really bad movie. I give it a 1.5, and only that much because of Wahlberg, and that might be too much. Now we turn to a movie you can catch on pay-per-view, the romantic comedy that got Helen Hunt an Oscar nomination. I don't know how, but more on that later. It's called The Sessions, and it's based on the amazing, uplifting, true story of Mark O'Brien. He's a childhood polio survivor who's been paralyzed since childhood and lives for the most part in an iron lung. Then, in his late 30s, he decides he wants to have sex and hires a sex surrogate, Helen Hunt, to make it happen, and with whom he falls in love.
So?
Your money's on the desk over there.
Yes, it is. Thank you.
That was the wrong way to start off.
It really was. Shall we start again?
Please, you start.
Although the aim is for us to have sex, I'm not a prostitute. You don't have to pay me up front. I have nothing against prostitutes, but there's a difference. We can talk about that later.
I'm sorry.
The other thing is, There's a limit to the number of sessions we can have. Did Lara mention that when you saw her?
I'm sorry. I don't remember.
The limit is 6, but that gives us plenty of opportunity to explore.
6.
So, I understand you're able to have an erection.
Yes, but not by choice.
Do you know how many men there are who would give anything for a natural erection? Is this your place?
No, it's a friend's. The only bedroom furniture I have at my place is an iron lung. I've been wondering maybe about possibly buying a futon, you know, in case the need arose.
Might be worth thinking about.
I've got the space, I think. It can be expensive, though, a nice futon. I mean, how much do you think a good one would cost?
Mike, take a deep breath. And let go.
Do I seem anxious?
You do a little.
Now, the problem I had with this one is that O'Brien's real story is so incredible. What this man had to overcome and did. He graduated college, he lived alone, he was a published poet, he had a wonderful sense of humor about it all. I wanted to see a lot more of that. The search for the sex part of his life, although very poignant, to me just got boring after a while.
Picture yourself as a 6-year-old boy at the beach. Can you do that?
Yes, very easily.
Describe some of your feelings.
I feel exhilarated. Running along the Atlantic Ocean, I feel the wind, wet sand between my toes.
Do you really feel like him?
Yes, I really feel like him.
And can you really picture him?
I don't understand what you mean. I said I could feel like him. Of course I could picture him.
From the outside. I mean as an adult. As you are now. Looking at him with his crew cut and his little face.
Yes.
And are you mad at him? Do you blame him for getting polio? Was it his fault?
Now, John Hawkes was really good as Mark O'Brien, but Hunt, I'm sorry. I'll give her props for being willing to take off her clothes and be totally nude on the big screen. She does look great. Maybe that's how she got her Oscar nod. Maybe Hawks should have gotten one. But Hunt's try at a Massachusetts accent is bad at best. And I thought her performance was only so-so. Very eh. And the same with the movie. Just so-so. I'll give it a 2.5. Let me know if you agree or not. Next up is a movie based on a character created by the novelist Donald Westlake. It's called Parker. The good news, most of it was shot right here in Palm Beach County and in West Palm. Unfortunately, that's about it for the good news.
Okay, Parker, cards on the table. I'm gonna need the whole score for this next thing. So, if you were me, what would you do with a guy like you?
Divide up the shares and that'd be the end of it.
What if you decided not to do that?
I'd kill him while I had a chance.
Jesus Christ.
What? The movie's about a thief called Parker, played by Jason Statham, who's double-crossed by his criminal crew and left for dead. On the way to seeking revenge against the aforementioned crew, i.e. killing them and stealing their next big score, Parker somehow meets with a down-and-out realtor. Yep, you heard it right. A down-and-out realtor played by Florida's own Jennifer Lopez.
Here's the deal. Don't ask me any questions because I'm only going to tell you what I want to tell you. The man who calls himself Rodrigo took something from me. He's in business with three other men. They're here for a robbery and they're going to use their house to lay low when they're done.
So, you let them steal something. You steal it from them. I help you. And I get a commission. You're gonna kill them, aren't you?
I never said that, Leslie. You did. Civilized people need to follow rules. I'm just gonna put things right.
Well, at least she gets a commission. Come on, the whole thing is so ridiculous. I've come up with my own Parker checklist. A going through the motions, monotone, although really good-looking Jason Statham, check. A not as bad, although really great-looking J-Lo, check. A bloated, over-the-hill, not good-looking at all Nick Nolte, check. Gratuitous violence and gore, check. The movie's just bad. I haven't read the books, but they have to be better. It's predictable, insulting, and at times, really disgusting. The only thing that saves it from a zero are all the shots of Florida and Jenny from the Block in a bikini. I give it a one. This week in our classic movie segment, we're going to talk about 1954's On the Waterfront, a truly seminal movie in the annals of Hollywood. We're happy to once again be joined today by Carol Watson, professor of film at Lynn University in Boca Raton. Let's watch Marlon Brando and Rod Steiger in this memorable scene from On the Waterfront.
It wasn't him, Charlie, it was you. You remember that night in the garden, you came down my dressing room and said, kid, this ain't your night. We're going for a price on Wilson. You remember that? This ain't your night. My night, I could have taken Wilson apart. So what happens? He gets the title shot outdoors in a ballpark, and what do I get? A one-way ticket to Palookaville. You was my brother, Charlie. You should have looked out for me a little bit. You should have taken care of me just a little bit so I wouldn't have to take them dives for the short-end money.
Well, I had some bets down for you. You saw some money.
You don't understand. I could have had class. I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody instead of a bum, which is what I am. Let's face it. It was you, Charlie.
Boy, the names connected to this movie reek of greatness. As does the movie producer Sam Spiegel, who, by the way, produced African Queen under the name S.P. Eagle. Writer Bud Schulberg wrote the novel The Harder They Fall, which was turned into what was to be my father's last movie. Director Elia Kazan, East of Eden, Streetcar Named Desire. And along with Brando and Rod Steiger, who you saw there, stars included Eva Marie Saint, Carl Malden, and Marty Balsam. Now, before we talk about Brando, let's talk, you have some insight into the scene we just saw.
Yeah, film historians write about this scene director Elia Kazan, most of the film was shot on location, very little studio work, and they had a studio for this scene, but it was a very, very small studio. And in that very, very small studio was half of a cab, the back half of the cab. And Kazan came to the set expecting there to be rear projection, which means that we would see imagery of the streets as the cab would drive by, but there was no rear projection. And he was really upset and really angry at Spiegel. And one of the crew guys said, I just took a cab this morning, and in the back, covering the back window was Venetian blinds. Why don't we use Venetian blinds?
And so they did.
So they did.
And you saw them.
Right.
Now, in that scene, you can see Marlon Brando, I mean, you could see the greatness, but there was a different side of that Brando showed of men. It was a different kind of male that he projected.
Yeah, this was the beginning of the new acting, the method style, which was a practice by which actors were trained so that they could access deeper emotional levels. And Brando in this film brings out also a new masculinity, a masculinity that's a lot more vulnerable. And if you watch his scenes in this case, and also with Eva Marie Saint.
We talked about this when he puts on the glove.
Right, when he's walking with her and she drops a glove and he ends up, it was his improvisation. It was nothing that Kazan told him to do. And there's also something about when you watch Brando in the scenes, is that the movie almost becomes another movie. He's in tune with his own rhythms. It's almost like you're not sure if he's forgetting his lines. It's so immediate, it's so real, and it conveys, you know, the ambivalences, the confusion, the hesitations that we have when we talk to somebody who we have in conflict with. In this case, he knows that he has betrayed the Eva Marie Saint character. He was somewhat responsible for the death of her brother.
Now, Eva Marie Saint, I mean, this was one of her first movies, if not her first.
This was her first film.
And she was absolutely brilliant in the movie. Now, was a lot of that Kazan? Because Kazan is one of the most highly thought of directors ever.
I think it's Kazan. He doesn't take a lot of credit for his actors. He just takes credit for the casting of them and says that he just likes to leave them alone.
Now, the writer Bud Schulberg and Elia Kazan both kind of had the same aim when making this movie, right?
Yeah, they both, I think, independent of each other, had an interest in the docks and the life of the longshoremen, and so they found a project where they could work on it together.
And the look, I mean, the look of the movie, it was so New York, it was so
gritty.
Gritty.
And grim.
Oh, yeah. Yes, it was, and that added so much to it. You had said before that movies that this was the first Hollywood movie that really looked like that in that way. What
yeah.
did you mean by that?
I mean that it looks like a documentary. You know, it's not glamorized. The daytime scenes are really gray and grim, and though the nighttime scene are more high contrast and shot in what I would say is the German expressionistic style of black blacks and white whites, but also the faces of all the bit players and the secondary and tertiary characters are all really interesting, craggy faces, and they shot it during winter when it was really cold and the actors were freezing, but Kazan wanted that gaunt, strained look on their faces to contribute to that gritty look.
Except for Brando, which you had just mentioned to me before, which I didn't know, he wore eyeliner.
Yeah, if you watch it, he's got eyeliner both on his top and bottom lids, and which is a little bit feminine, actually.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm not Marlon, though. Thank you very much, Carol.
Okay.
Now it's time to delve into the Bogart on Movies mailbox. In my review of Gangster Squad, I mentioned that in the movie, Emma Stone was compared to my mother, Lauren Bacall. Here's what I said. And in the movie, she's told like she looks like my mother, Lauren Bacall. What do you think?
What's your racket, handsome?
I'm a Bible salesman.
You want to take me away from all this and make an honest woman out of me?
No, ma'am. I was just hoping to take you to bed.
Well, writing to me on YouTube, LarkAscending66 told me what she thought of people who felt Emma Stone looked like my mother at about the same age. She said, only in a feverish publicist's dreams. Well, thanks, LarkAscending. Emma Stone's a beautiful woman, and so is my mother. Marvin in Coconut Creek asked, did you ever meet Marilyn Monroe? No, but I met people who'd worked with her, and my mom, she always said that Marilyn Monroe was a vastly underrated actress. And by the way, if you look on YouTube, on Google, you'll find a picture of my father next to Marilyn Monroe, kind of giving a little peek, a Seinfeld peek, at her cleavage. You can email me, send me your comments and questions to stevebogart@wxel.org, and include your name and your hometown. This week, Carla looks at women in movies. One of them, a 50-foot woman, and the other, Catwomen of the Moon.
Ah! once a normal, voluptuously beautiful woman. She drove into a nightmare of horror and saw descending from the sky a titanic monster whose fearsome touch became a frightful curse.
You think I'm drunk, don't you? All of you! I'm not drunk! I'm not! You've got to believe me!
Please.
It was right in the middle of the highway, 30 feet tall!
Once she's in the booby hatch, throw the key away. That'll put you in the driver's seat. You'd make a wild driver, Harry. With $50 million.
What she saw was beyond belief until others, too, faced its hideous, uncontrollable menace. Attack of the 50-foot woman, incredibly huge, with incredible desires for love and vengeance.
Where are your menfolk?
You're the first man I've ever seen. Go, Kip.
Ellen, what's the matter?
Danger, Kip. They want to kill you. They'll take the spaceship and they'll make me go with them.
Well, how?
They can, Kip. They control me.
You'll share man's greatest thrill as you rocket through space to the lost moon city of alluring, ferocious cat women. Theirs is the fevered fury of life without love, goading them to lure men into the den of bloodthirsty moon monsters. Driving them to tempt men in the deadly cave of moon gold, flaming into a wild lust to conquer man and destroy the world.
For Steve's real pick this week, little change of pace. How about what I think may have been the best party ever and what may be the best documentary ever? And that's Woodstock. I know you were thinking about who that was. Well, it was Canned Heat. Do you remember where you were that weekend? I do. My first wife and I've had two of those, by the way, were going to leave on the Thursday before the concert, but then we heard on the radio that the New York freeway was closed, so we didn't go. I still kick myself for missing that one. Speaking of missing it, there are some huge names who were invited, but for one reason or another, didn't go. The Beatles, Bob Dylan, The Doors, Led Zeppelin, The Byrds, Frank Zappa, The Moody Blues, Jethro Tull, and unbelievably, Roy Rogers. Yes, Roy Rogers, who was going to sing Happy Trails to close the concert. This is a wonderful trip back to the 60s. If you haven't seen it, do. It's a great journey. Until next week.
Send Steve your picks for the Oscars this year. Email Steve Bogart who you think will win the Oscar in these categories: Best Actor, Best Actress, Best Director, Best Supporting Actor, Best Supporting Actress, Best Movie of the Year. Steve will give you his choices on his Oscar special Friday, February 2nd at 5:30 p.m., just 2 days before the Oscars are given out. Send your picks to Steve Bogart at WXEL.org. If you pick them correctly, you may be a guest on a future Bogart on Movies. In case there are a number of winners, one will be selected at random to appear on the program. Thank you and good luck.